Good morning, folks. Welcome to the topics class. Good to see you today. We're starting a brand new series today as we're going to be doing a study on the Godhead. The Godhead is the biblical name for Trinity. The Trinity is the doctrine of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the Bible name is the Godhead. So as we begin this new series, we're going to be looking at some of, I should say, this series, the Godhead, is some of the deeper things in the Word of God. It, you know, when God created this earth, He put up on the surface of the earth the things that were necessary for life, like water. We need water, so He covered the earth, two-thirds of the earth's surface, with water. At the bottom of the food chain is vegetation, and so vegetation is up on the surface of the earth. The air that we need to breathe is on the surface of the earth, and so forth. But the precious things He buried in the earth, gold, silver, diamonds, rubies, emeralds, and so forth. If you want those, you got to dig for them. Well, He constructed the Word of God like He constructed planet Earth. The necessary things are right up on the surface. The plan of salvation. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. Acts 16:31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. How to be saved? It's right up there on the surface of the Word of God. Any lost sinner can go and pick up a Bible and open it up, and the salvation verse will hit him in the face, and he can act upon it and be saved. But the Bible says that there are the deep things of God. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 2:10, it says, God hath revealed them unto us by His Spirit, for the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. Well, the doctrine of the Trinity, or the Bible name, Godhead, is a deep truth. And with our limited mentalities, we can't really understand it and comprehend it, but we can study it and learn many things about it. And so that's what we're going to be doing for a number of weeks now as we fellowship together. So let's begin with prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we pray now that You would bless our study together, open our minds, our comprehension, and may the Holy Spirit of God be our teacher to teach us these truths. Lord, as we confess to You, we have finite minds, and this is an infinite truth. So, Lord, we pray that You would help us to learn it and understand it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, the cults and the liberals cannot understand the Bible, and so they don't believe in the Trinity. So you talk to somebody from one of the cults, Jehovah's Witnesses or whatever, and they say, oh no, you can't find the Trinity in the Bible, or you can't find the Godhead in the Bible. You talk to some liberal theologian, doesn't believe in the shed blood of Christ is necessary for forgiveness of sins, and they'll tell you, oh no, there's no triune God or anything like that. Well, that's because they can't comprehend the Scripture. But the Bible, as you begin to search it out and study it, which the Word of God says we're to do, study to show thyself approved unto God, workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. As you get into it and begin to study it, you find out God is a triune being. He is one God, but He's in three persons. This is an ancient diagram. I'm not sure what century it really was originated in, maybe the first or the second century, something like that. But it's a study of the Godhead. And here it says Father, here it says Son, and here it says Holy Ghost. And it says the Father is not the Son. And the Son is not the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is not the Father. But the Father is God. The Son is God. The Holy Ghost is God. That's the best diagram that man can come up with to try to describe the Godhead. Well, as we said, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, but the word Godhead is in the Bible. It's in there three different times, and we want to make you aware of this particular great doctrine which is taught in the Word of God. So then, the first time that we see Godhead in the Scriptures is in Acts 17 and verse 29. It says, and we read there that the Godhead is not like pagan gods. Paul here in this verse says, "For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's devices." In other words, the Godhead is not like idols that men have created. So this is the first mention of the Godhead in the Bible. It's the first of the three times that word is used. Now, in your modern Bible translations, which for the most part have been translated by a bunch of liberals, NIV and all of those, they have systematically removed the word Godhead out of their translations because they don't believe in it. If the translators don't believe in the Godhead, they're going to remove it, and that is exactly what they did. This same verse, Acts 17:29, in the NIV reads, "Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold, silver, or stone," and so forth. Notice they've replaced Godhead with the divine being. Where is the Godhead in this verse? This is a special word. It's only used three times by God. And here they have changed it, removed it, and substituted the divine being. What does that actually do? The verse says that the Godhead is not like unto gold, silver, or stone images. Well, if you substitute divine being for Godhead, you're making God like all these other gods. You're taking the triune God right out of the Scriptures here. Then the second time that the Godhead is used, if you notice on your note sheets, is Romans 1:20, where we read that the Godhead can be seen in creation. Romans 1:20 says, "The invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen." In other words, you can see the hand of God in creation, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead. The Godhead can be seen in creation. A triune God has created a triune creation. Beginning with man, God is a triune, man is triune, body, soul, and spirit. And all things in creation are triune entities that give us a picture from creation itself of the Godhead. But here again, the modern translators have taken that out. And Romans 1:20 and the NIV, you find here that Godhead has been replaced by divine nature, by the divine nature. So where is the Godhead here? Again, it has been removed. And then the third time that we have the word Godhead is that we find in Colossians 2:9 that all the attributes of the Father can be found in the Son. It says, "For in him here is Jesus, in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily." In other words, Jesus is the bodily manifestation of all the attributes of God. This is the verse we're going to focus on this morning, Colossians 2:9. However, in the modern translations, that is taken out, and Godhead is replaced by the deity. And so again, we ask the question, where is the Godhead. Well, the word Godhead is in the Bible three times. In the modern translations, in the NIV, it's 0 for 3. Nice little poetry there. In the NIV, it's 0 for 3. The NIV and other modern translations, they flunk out. By the way, talking about the NIV, if you have an NIV, they have a new name for it. It's called NIV 1984. And they're not going to publish it anymore. If you've got an NIV, it's now obsolete. Then they came out with a new NIV called TNIV. And that was totally rejected, almost totally rejected by the public. So this year, they're coming out with a brand new NIV, which is worse than the two predecessors. Now, that's not part of our lesson. I just let you know that, okay? All right. We're focusing on Colossians 2:9 this morning, that in Jesus dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. What we're going to do is seek to do is we're going to consider two different things. We're going to consider, first of all, the unity of God the Father and God the Son. The unity. What is said about the one can be said about the other. The second thing we're going to look at is we're going to study what did the Father and the Son do before creation began. The Bible tells us there are lots of things in the Bible that tell us what the Father and the Son were doing before creation. And we'll see that they were both doing the same thing. All right, let's begin. First of all, as we study God the Father, we note that God has revealed himself to us in the Scriptures. If you want to know about God, you find it in the Bible. Don't be like the New Agers that say, if you want to know God, look inward. Inward is a heart that is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Jeremiah 17:9. Some of the others, cults and things that are around say, look to nature. If you want to know God, look to nature. Well, you can see God in nature, but you can't see Jesus Christ in nature that as the Savior of the world. Others say that you can turn to the occult, witchcraft, sorcery, and so forth, that you find God there. Absolutely not. Those things are forbidden in the Word of God. If you want to know God, you want to learn about God, you want to know God better, you have to look into the Scripture. So the first question, question we're going to deal with, first of all here, is what is God the Father like? Now, Colossians 2:9, once again, says, in him, meaning Jesus, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In other words, the Son is the bodily manifestation of the Father. So in light of Colossians 2:9, what is God the Father like? Well, first of all, we see he is spirit. He is spirit. In John 4:24, it says God is a spirit. Now, the article A is not found in the Greek text. That verse should read, God is spirit. He's not a spirit per se, but he is spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Going to the next page, we have a passage from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses tells them the Lord, notice that's Jehovah, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, that's Jehovah. Jehovah spake unto you out of the midst of the fire. We heard the voice of the words, but saw no similitude. Well, that word similitude means a shape, an embodiment, or a body, or a likeness. He says, God was speaking to you, and you saw no bodily form at all. Only ye heard a voice. And the Lord commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments. And then at the end of the passage, again he reiterates, for ye saw no manner of similitude or embodiment on the day that the Lord spake unto you in Horeb out of the midst of the fire. They saw nothing because God is a spirit. Well, when we read the Scriptures, we find that Jesus also is a spirit. 1 Peter 1:11, here it talks about the spirit of Christ, searching what or what manner of time the spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify. Jesus is a spirit. God is a spirit. God the Father is a spirit. God the Son is a spirit as well. Then, secondly, God the Father is invisible. Notice Colossians 1:15. Now, this is actually talking about Jesus here. It says, who is the image? Image of what? The image of the invisible God. God is invisible. He's spirit, and he is invisible. 1 Timothy 1:17 says, now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible. Hebrews 11:27, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. And notice in Romans 1:20 that we saw the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. God's invisible attributes you can see in creation. Okay, so God the Father is invisible. But as we look at the scriptures, we also see that Jesus is invisible, because in that verse, Colossians 1:15, he is the image of the invisible God. So the Father is invisible, and God the Son is invisible. By the way, I forgot to mention to you, the reason your lesson sheets are so thick today, we've put all these PowerPoint slides in the back of your lesson sheets so you can have them, because we're using 31 slides this morning. And so that's a lot of scripture. Each one is a one or two verses of scripture. So you can have them with you to refer to. All right, so God is invisible. Thirdly, God the Father is immutable, which means he does not and will not change. Malachi 3:6, the scripture says, for I am the Lord, Jehovah, I change not. James 1:17, James tells us every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. That's God the Father, with whom is no variableness, which means change, neither shadow of turning. There's no movement with God. He does not change. The reference here is to a sundial. If you have a sundial, as the sun goes across the sky, the shadow on the sundial moves and it tells you what time of day it is. Suppose you had a sundial that it's sitting there and as the sun goes across the sky, the shadow doesn't move. It just stays the same place. Well, that's what James is teaching here about God. He says the shadow of turning, the sundial, it doesn't change. God does not move. He's immutable. Then in Hebrews 6:17, wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel. The immutability of his counsel. God does not change. But when we read the scriptures, what do we read about Jesus? He is immutable. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. He does not change. Then, number four, we read that God is called the living God. Many times in the scriptures, he's referred to as the living God. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 10 and 12, but the Lord is the true God. He is the living God. And it goes on and says, he made the earth by his power. He established the world by his wisdom, and he stretched out the heaven by his discretion. In 1 Thessalonians 1:9, it says, for they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we had unto you, how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. He is the living God. Hebrews 10:31 warns us, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Well, what do we read about Jesus? Jesus is the living God. In John 6:51, he said, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. Jesus came down from heaven. The living God came down from heaven. So in John 6:51, we see the living God is here on earth. In Hebrews 7:25, the scene shifts back to heaven again. Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. This shows us Christ as our great high priest. Right now, he's up in heaven, ever living. He's the living God, ever living to make intercession for us. Well, then we read farther, number five here, that God the Father is incorruptible. Romans 1:23 says, they change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image like unto corruptible man. This is idolatry. So they changed God's image here. The triune God, his image has been changed to four-footed beast and man and creeping things and so forth. Over in Egypt, they worshiped creeping things. They worshiped the scarab or a beetle. And in Africa, different tribes, they worshiped creeping things, bugs and that creep on the earth. They changed the image of the uncorruptible God. But when we search the scriptures, we find that Jesus was uncorruptible also. The prophecy of Psalm 16:10, this is about Jesus. Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption. His body did not corrupt because he is the incorruptible God. You say, how do we know that's Jesus it's talking about? Well, here's Acts 2:31. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. He is the incorruptible God. Then sixthly, we see that God the Father is the everlasting God. Romans 16:26, it speaks to him there. It says, according to the commandment of the everlasting God. We turn to the scriptures and we find Jesus also is the everlasting God. Micah 5:2 prophesies his birth in Bethlehem. And it says, Bethlehem of Ephrathah, though thou be little amongst the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. That baby that was born in Bethlehem that we just celebrated his birth less than a month ago, a couple weeks ago. The Lord Jesus, he is from, the Bible says, from everlasting. God the Father is from everlasting. Jesus is from everlasting. Unless you got a modern Bible version. If you got an NIV or some other version, Jesus is not from everlasting in there. Because they've taken the word everlasting out and have replaced it with the word ancient times. Two words, ancient times. And they have also added a word in their origin. Jesus had no origin. They've manipulated that verse to take the deity of Christ right out of that verse. Micah 5:2 teaches the deity of Christ that he is God. He is from everlasting. He does not have an origin, and he is not from ancient times, as modern versions have translated it. If you got one of those, you need to get rid of it and get a King James Bible and learn the truth of God here. All right. You know, we're living in the Laodicean age. It shouldn't be surprising. This is the great age of apostasy. We've got a bunch of apostate Bibles out there, translated by a bunch of apostate scholars. No surprise there at all. Well, let's move along. Number seven, God the Father is called blessed. 1 Timothy 1:11. According to the glorious gospel of the blessed God. The blessed God. Well, Jesus is referred to numerous times as blessed. He is the blessed one. In Luke 19:8, he rides into triumphantly into Jerusalem. Blessed be the king that cometh in the name of the Lord. That's a fulfillment of Zechariah 9:9. And then Titus 2:13, looking for that blessed hope. What is the blessed hope? The glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. He's called God in that verse also. Okay, so he is blessed. He's the blessed God. And number eight, he's great. He is great. God is great. Titus 2:13, the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the great God. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 20, he is called that great shepherd of the sheep, the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep. He is great. Only God is great. You know, in the book of Daniel, the king there, he says to Daniel, he says, I would have made you a great man, but Daniel was more content to be a good man than a great man, and he didn't compromise with the king. And there's only one that is great, and that is God the Father and God the Son. All right, let's look at the next one, number nine. He is a person. Many have an idea that God is some abstract form out there floating around the universe someplace. Unitarianism teaches that all things are God. That's pantheism. You can find God here, there, and everywhere. It's not what the Bible teaches us. He is a person, and he has a name. And Jeremiah 10:16 tells us, the portion of Jacob is not like them, for he is the former of all things, and Israel is the rod of his inheritance. The Lord of hosts is his name. He has a proper name, the Lord of hosts. And that word Lord, notice there is all capitals, that's Jehovah. That is his name. Well, Jesus has a name, a divine name. The angel announced in Luke 1:31, and behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. And we read in Philippians 2:20 that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. Those that teach us that or tell us that Jesus is not God, they've never read Philippians 2:20, obviously. Why would all of creation bow just at the mention of the name of Jesus and worship if he was not God? Okay, so after seeing that he has a name, number 10, he is holy. Psalm 99 tells us, for he is holy. Who is it talking about? The Lord, Jehovah, our God. And the verse 9 says, for the Lord our God is holy. We look in the scripture, and this designation of holiness is applied to the Lord Jesus. Hebrews 7:26, he is our high priest, and he is holy. For such a high priest became us who is holy. He is a holy God. Then, number 11, God the Father is love. 1 John 4:8, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Not only does he love, he is love. He is the manifestation of love, the personification of love. He is love. We read that Jesus also is love. 1 Corinthians 5:14 talks about the love of Christ. Romans 8:35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? So he also is love. But we continue on in John 15:9, as the Father hath loved me, here's God the Father. Jesus said, as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. And then in the 10th verse, if you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept the Father's commandments and abide in his love. So Jesus is love. God the Father is love. Then number 12, God the Father is merciful. Aren't you glad? He is merciful. The 103rd Psalm, and by the way, there's many verses on all of these. We're just putting one or two in. But he is merciful. Psalm 103, verse 11 and verse 17. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. From everlasting to everlasting. The mercy of God. Well, we read about Jesus that he also is merciful. And this is concerning his priestly work. Wherefore, in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest. And he is our merciful and faithful high priest. He is merciful. He pleads your case before God every single day of your life. And Satan is up there without ceasing day and night. There's no day and night in heaven, but the day and nights here on earth, Satan is up there in heaven being the accuser of the brethren, as we read in Revelation chapter 12, accusing the brethren, and Jesus is the merciful high priest pleading our case before him. Well, not only is God merciful, but he is also faithful. 1 Corinthians 10:13, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful. God is faithful. 1 Thessalonians 5:24, faithful is he that calleth you. 2 Thessalonians 3:3, but the Lord is faithful. What do we read about the priestly work of Christ? He also is faithful. He is, in Hebrews 2:17, our faithful high priest. He's a merciful and faithful high priest. We need a high priest, one who stands in the presence of God, representing you and I every time that we sin. All right, so he is faithful. And then, this is the last one now, he is eternal. He is eternal. God the Father is eternal. The eternal God, Deuteronomy 33:27, the eternal God is thy refuge. He is eternal. We read about the Lord Jesus there in 1 Timothy 1:16. It says, now unto the King eternal. The King is eternal. Jesus is, this is the King. He's going to be the King of kings and Lord of lords, the Bible says. He's eternal, immortal, invisible, and the only wise God, and so forth. Well, that verse also refers to him as God. So those are 14 attributes about God the Father that are identical with God the Son. So that should give us the first clue concerning the Godhead, that maybe God the Father and God the Son, maybe they're one and the same, one God in two different persons here. And then when we get to the Holy Spirit, one God in three persons here. All right? But have you ever considered, what did God do before he created us? What did God do before the creation of the world? We're going to take a step back in time. In fact, we're going to take a step back before time began. And we're going to see the activities of God the Father and God the Son before creation took place. The scripture is filled with verses that tell us what they were doing back before the world began. And we find out that what the Father was doing is identical with what the Son was doing also. Back there, before there was any solar system, any universe, any galaxies, stars, planets, anything. Back before the foundations of the earth were laid. So the first thing we're going to see is, if God, since God is eternal, what did he do before creation? This is the next step in our study of God the Father as we study the Godhead. Well, the first thing we learn about him, of what he was doing back there before creation, he was loving his Son, Jesus. In John chapter 17 and verse 24, Jesus says, Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. And then here right at the end of the verse, for thou lovest me when? Before the foundation of the world, before creation. Jesus acknowledges here the Father loved him before creation took place. Let the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons and all them put that in their pipe and smoke it. Before the foundation of the world. Also the liberals. Jesus was just a man. You know, the Father loved him back before the foundations of the world. What do we read concerning Jesus? What did Jesus do before creation? In John 14:31, he says, but that the world may know that I love the Father. How much? As the Father gave me commandment, even so I do, and so forth. So, before foundation, they were loving one another. God loved the Son, and the Son loved the Father. All right, the second thing that God the Father and God the Son were doing before creation, is He established wisdom. There seems to be a shortage of wisdom nowadays, but He established wisdom. In Proverbs chapter 8, verse 22 and 23, Solomon writes here, "The Lord possessed me in the beginning of His way, before His works of old." In other words, before creation. "I was set up from everlasting," before creation. "From the beginning," Genesis 1:1, "in the beginning." Before, from the beginning, or ever the earth was, before the earth was even made. And you read the context of what it's talking about there, and it's talking about wisdom. God established wisdom. If you look in 1 Corinthians 2:7, Paul says, "We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained," when? "Before the world." Before the world, before creation took place, He established wisdom. But when we turn to the Word of God, we see that that wisdom is Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 1:30, "But of Him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us." And he lists four things there, first one being wisdom. Jesus is wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. So He established wisdom. Then the third thing we notice, what He did, what went on with God the Father and God the Son before the creation took place. In John 17:5, He says, "And now, O Father, glorify Thou me with Thy own self, with the glory I had with Thee," when? "Before the world was." In other words, eternity, back before time began. And we see that Jesus, or that God, basked in the glory that was His Shekinah glory. When in John 17:5 here, we see that that glory was the same glory that is the glory of the Son, "with the glory which I had with Thee." I, meaning Jesus, Thee, God the Father, "with the glory I had with Thee before the world was." Back in eternity, we find next that God the Father created the angels. Back before the universe was created, He had to create the angels. The angels were here when creation took place. They had already been created. And in Job chapter 38, He talks about creation. And He says to Job, this is God the Father speaking, He says, "Where wast thou when I laid the foundation of the earth?" So this takes us right back to creation. "Declare if thou hast understanding." And then He tells us what happens at creation. "When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy." Two names there applied to the angels, the morning stars and the sons of God. And we find that in other places in the scripture. The angels are referred to as stars and as sons of God. And He says at creation, the morning stars, the angels, and the sons of God, the angels, were all rejoicing and shouting for joy at creation itself. Jesus, the Bible tells us, created those angels. In Colossians 1:16, it's talking about Jesus here. "By Him were all things created." What things? Well, it says all things, but things that are in heaven, that's where the angels are, and that are in earth, visible, invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, and now watch this, or principalities or powers. That's angelic beings, the principalities and powers. God set up a form of angelic overseership in which He divided up His planet Earth, gave it to princes, angels that were princes, and He divided up into principalities. A prince was over a principality. Satan duplicated the same thing. God has principalities and powers, and Satan also, because he's the counterfeiter, he has principalities and powers. But God, Jesus, it says in Colossians 1:16, created those principalities and powers. So when we read in Job chapter 38 there that the morning stars sang together and the sons of God shouted for joy, they had been created by the Lord Jesus himself. You can read about the principalities and powers in the book of Daniel. When Daniel prayed, God dispatched an angel to answer his prayer. And that angel was held up for 21 days, he says, by the prince of Persia. Which, not talking about a human prince, he's talking about an angelic being. Up there, someplace between heaven and earth, he was held up, he was detained for 21 days. And finally, Michael, the archangel, came and joined in the fight. And so the angel could finally get through with his answer to prayer to Daniel, but took him 21 days to do it. Now, it talks about these principalities and powers. Also mentions the Prince of Greece. It's another angelic being that is up there belonging to Satan. So, principalities and powers. You read about a lot about them in the book of Ephesians, that they are God's creation here. All right. The next thing, he devised the plan of salvation for men. Way back before he created the universe, before any of us were alive or any of our ancestors alive, he devised a plan of salvation for mankind because he knew that man would sin. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 through 20, I'm not going to read all of this because of time, but if you drop right down to the bottom part there, it says that we're redeemed with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, before creation, but was manifest in these last times for you. The precious blood of Christ is a lamb without spot and without blemish. Before the world began, in the heart and mind of God, Jesus went to the cross and shed his blood back before this universe even existed. It was in the heart and mind of God. He devised that plan of salvation. But we also read in the scripture that Jesus had a part in devising that plan of salvation. Revelation 13:8. All that dwell upon the earth shall worship him. This is talking about the Antichrist, whose names are not written in the book of life, notice, of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Jesus was a party to God's decision to send him to the cross and die for the sins of men that had not even been created yet. He helped devise the plan of salvation. And then he foreknew all those that were going to be saved. In Ephesians 1:4, it says, according to, as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. We were chosen in him before the foundation of the world. Titus 1:2, in the hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. 2 Timothy 1:9, to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. So, Jesus, the Bible, or God the Father, we are told, has the foreknowledge of who would be saved and who would not be saved. This is not predetermining who's going to be saved. It's simply God's foreknowledge. Well, Jesus also has foreknowledge. We read in John, Jesus therefore knowing all things. That's John 18. John 19, Jesus knowing that all things were now accomplished. Jesus had a foreknowledge of the cross. He warned the disciples about the cross on numerous occasions. God has foreknowledge. Satan doesn't. God has foreknowledge. God the Son has foreknowledge. And then we read that he offered Jesus there for a sacrifice, Revelation 13:8. All that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world, the Lamb that was slain. We read in Hebrews 19:14 that the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit, notice what it says, offered himself. He offered himself. God offered up Jesus for the price of our sins. And the Bible says Jesus offered himself. So what the Father and the Son were doing, they were doing simultaneously. Then we find that he recorded the names of the lost and recorded the names of the saved. In Revelation 17:8, it talks about those whose names were not written in the book of life, notice, from the foundation of the world. All of those who are put their trust in Christ, your name is in the book of life. And those whose names are not in the book of life are going into the lake of fire for all eternity. So he knows whose names were to be in the book of life. God the Father knows that. It's there. But when we come to Revelation 21:27, we find out who owns that book of life. That book that's got your name in it, that God the Father himself wrote your name in that book, we find out who owns it. It's Jesus. They which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Jesus is the Lamb. The Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. 29 times in the book of Revelation, he is referred to as the Lamb. It's the Lamb's book of life. And then, I'm going to have to hurry through this, the mystery. It was God the Father who devised the mystery. We talked about the mystery in the last series that we just finished up. Ephesians 3:9, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God. The mystery that was hid from the beginning of the world. Again, we read it in Colossians 1:26-27. The mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations. He says, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We read in the scriptures that that mystery, that Jews and Gentiles would be brought together in one body, which is the church, the body of Christ. That's a New Testament ministry that was revealed to the Apostle Paul. And that Jesus had a part, he devised that mystery in Ephesians 3:4, whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery. What mystery? The mystery of Christ. It's his mystery. The church is his body. Then we read that he formulated the gospel of grace. It says, which was kept secret since the world began. Well, that gospel of grace is called in 1 Corinthians 9:18 the gospel of Christ. It's God's gospel, but it's called the gospel of Christ. And then he formulated or planned the kingdom, the millennial kingdom. That hasn't even happened yet. The church has to be raptured, the tribulation has to run its course, and then Jesus has to come back again, and then that kingdom will be set up. But God the Father planned that kingdom from eternity. Matthew 25:34, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you when? From the foundation of the world, before creation took place. That kingdom, millennial kingdom, was planned out by God. But when we read about the kingdom, what Jesus taught about the kingdom, he says it is my kingdom and it's not of this world. Again, my kingdom. Again, but now is my kingdom. Three times in that verse, Jesus says that kingdom is my kingdom. It belongs to me. And he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God could do all of this. All these things he did before creation because he inhabits eternity. Eternity is where there is no time. It's where before time began. Isaiah 57:15, for thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. Well, what we read about Jesus in the scripture, that he is, in Hebrews 1:3, the brightness of God's glory and the express image of his person. And that word express means an exact copy. So number one, Jesus has the same brightness of the Father's glory, and he is an exact copy of the Father. So this is the first leg in our study of the triune God. We see God the Father and God the Son here, and scripture very strongly suggests here that they are one God, the first two persons of the Godhead. Let's have prayer, and we'll be dismissed. Thank you now, Heavenly Father, for your blessings, and Lord, help us to comprehend this deep mystery, Lord, of how one God can be in three persons. Lord, it just boggles the mind. But give us to understand, Lord, that this is what the Scripture teaches. And we don't have to understand it to believe it. All we have to do is accept it. And so, Lord, as we get deeper into it each week, seeing more and more how God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit are all one God, Lord, we pray that we might be rooted and grounded in the most holy faith till you come again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming, folks. You are dismissed.